Okay, hello everyone and welcome. And for those of you who don't know me, my name is Annette Williams and I'm the chair of the Women's Spirituality PhD program and the Women, Gender, Spirituality and Social Justice MA program at the California Institute of Integral Studies. So again, welcome to the fourth and final event in the month-long Women's Spirituality 30th Anniversary Celebratory Series. When I discovered that by happy coincidence, the collection of essays in the Routledge anthology, Spiritual Healing from Sexual Violence and an Intersectional Guide, features three works by alumna of the CIIS Women's Spirituality PhD program, it was my immediate wish to bring the three of us together in conversation. Unfortunately, Sandra Sucedo, who graduated in 2019, could not be with us today. But I'm very happy to have Marion Dumont here with us. So welcome, Marion.
Thank you.
Okay. So Marion and I will read from and talk about our work in the area of healing sexual trauma. And by way of introduction, I'll read our brief bios that were used for the anthology. And I'll just start with my own. So as many of you know, I am an associate professor and chair in the Women's Spirituality Department at CIIS. My doctorate is in philosophy and religion with a specialization in women's spirituality. And my research interests have centered on sexual healing from sexual trauma and the theme of women's spiritual power and agency within the Yoruba Ifa tradition, with specific reference to the primordial feminine authority of Ajay. A recent offering is Wisdom of the Primordial Feminine, Wisdom of Women, Odu Ifa, and Yoruba religious traditions in Philo Sophia, Wisdom Goddess Traditions, that was edited by Debashis Banerjee and Robert McDermott. Marion Dumont, RN, PhD, completed a Bachelor of Science from Seattle Pacific University, focusing on maternal child nursing. In 2013, she earned a doctorate degree from the California Institute of Integral Studies in Philosophy and Religion, with a specialization in women's spirituality and a particular focus on women's mysteries, sacred arts, and healing. Over the course of her career, she has received training in other healing modalities, including therapeutic touch and Reiki. As a writer, artist, nurse, and practitioner of the healing arts, her work emerges out of personal experience and an understanding of the interconnectedness of nature, art, and spirituality. So I would like to now introduce again Marion Dumont and ask her to continue. So if I could start with your reading, however you'd like to start today.
Thank you so much. It's an honor to be a part of this celebration. I'm just going to read several short passages from the chapter, the anthology by Routledge Press, Spiritual Healing from Sexual Violence. The title of my chapter is Nature as Muse, and the focus is on nature, art, and dreams. Growing up, my siblings and I spent a great deal of time. Oh, excuse me. I was going to share my screen so you could have something nice to look at. And he showed me how to do this. So just take a minute.
Thank you, Marion. We are seeing it nicely, and the slideshow will begin shortly.
Wonderful. Growing up, my siblings and I spent a great deal of time outdoors. In nature, I felt free to be me. No judgment, no alienation, no awkwardness, just adventure and pure joy. The smell of the earth and the wind in the trees were our familiars, and the creatures of field, forest, and shore our delight. Outdoors in nature is where I developed a sense of belonging and connection, and it continues to be my refuge and place of contemplation. Engagement with the natural world is my healing strength. It's where I find balance, emotional regulation, and confidence. Philosophers, poets, scientists, and artists define nature in unique ways. When I use the word nature, it is simply a reference to the natural world, that physical world commonly perceived as being outside, a state that has not been humanly constructed. Biophilia is a term used to describe our desire to commune with nature. I don't think it's clean.
Thank you, Marion.
Yeah. Sociobiologist and author E.O. Wilson believes that our existence depends on this propensity. Our spirit is woven from it. Hope rises on its current. Engagement with life in the natural world enhances our mental, emotional, and spiritual development. Now from the section on art. To be heard and to be witnessed during times of grief is critical for healing to occur. Friends and family are often the ones we turn to during this time of crisis. However, for various reasons, we may be unable to share our experience with others or be comforted by them. Perhaps their comfort doesn't feel as if it is enough. For grief to unwind itself, one must become self-centered for a time. It is important to find what works best for you as you process your experience. The ebb and flow of emotions and the transformative process of healing requires grace and flexibility. Busy lives can make it difficult to find the time and space to do what you need to do to care for yourself. The practice of taking quiet walks in nature is one way that you can meet these needs. Wherever I am, even if it's only for a short visit, I make it a priority to orient myself to the place and find safe and pleasurable walks. It has been my experience, whether these walks are through the streets of an unfamiliar city, the outskirts of a small town, or the neighborhood near my apartment, that nature never disappoints, but continually astounds me with its wisdom and support. For me, learning to do arts and crafts is not so much about becoming an artist or a craftswoman, but about engaging with the creative process for the purpose of well-being. My creative process has become an integral part of my therapy. Sean McNiff writes in his book, Art Heals, that art and creativity are the soul's medicine, what the soul uses to minister to itself, cure its maladies, and restore its vitality. And that's why I do art, and hope that in sharing my experiences, you are inspired to take up some form of creative activity for your own pleasure and well-being. One last passage from the part on dreams. Dreams are sometimes disturbing, sometimes insightful, often elusive, but almost always interesting and self-revelatory. When we pay attention to our dream life and work with the material given to us, they can serve as guides and avenues for healing and self-development. You will find that the more you work with your dreams, the more you dream. I work with my dreams using a simple process of dream incubation that I created for myself. Dream incubation is not a new concept within Western culture. It was a key element in the healing practices of Asclepius and Hygieia, the Greco-Roman god and goddess of medicine. Temples and sacred healing centers, known as Asclepia, served as places where people would go to engage in various rites and practices, including dream incubation. The word incubate comes from the Latin verb incubare, to lie upon. Mabel Lang describes these dream centers in her book, Cure and Cult in Ancient Corinth. In describing the ritual of incubation, Lang draws a connection between nature and dreaming when she ascribes dreams to sacred Mother Earth. Dream incubation, ancient mythology, the earth and nature come together as part of a creative healing practice. Thank you. Unshare. And that was the last passage that I was reading.
Thank you, Marion. As I was saying while I was muted, it was really beautiful. The images were really wonderful and just evocative, and just, you know, this evocative of peace and healing, actually. And for everyone, we're going to get into a fuller conversation. But first, I'm going to share a bit of some excerpts from the piece that I wrote for the anthology, and also share an image here. Go back to share my screen. So are you all seeing the image of the altar?
Yes.
Okay, fantastic. So the piece that I wrote for the anthology was called Deconstruction and Reclamation, A Healing Journey. It's on the experience of childhood sexual abuse, personal ramifications, and my own grappling with its causes from sort of a broader lens of the social and cultural. So Ms. Baker is going to read the overview in a couple of excerpts. Childhood sexual abuse leaves scars that are deep, and it invariably impacts adult functioning. Accounts by women who have experienced childhood sexual abuse vary as to its impact on their lives. The trajectory of their self-development was invariably altered by the experience of trauma and childhood sexual abuse. One author states, "Violence sends deep roots into the heart." Childhood sexual abuse is described as a bodily violation of extreme humiliation and devastation. It silences our voices, numbs our bodies, warps our thinking, and closes our hearts. As a Black woman who was subjected to childhood sexual abuse, I echo the thoughts of a Black woman who survived rape at the hands of Black males. How could they do that to one of their own? As I acknowledge the extent to which incidents of childhood sexual abuse impacted my sense of self and personal identity, Charlotte Pierce Baker's question echoes in anguished tones because I suffered abuse at the hands of male family members. Indeed, how could they do that to one of their own? What in their cosmology, in their sense of relationship to self and the universe, enabled them to feel entitled to use my body for their gratification? And what was my cosmology that I seemingly acquiesced or would perceive victimization as acquiescence? The process of deconstruction might take a lifetime. Although a full deconstruction is highly improbable, given the complexity of interwoven factors that constitute the individual, because sexual abuse is just one of many factors that influence your development, it isn't always possible to isolate its effects from the other influences on your life. However, in an effort to unlock the mystery, I turned to Elaine Pagels to help my understanding of the theological ground from which modern dysfunctional views of sexuality sprouted. Severe attitudes towards women and children held by the early church fathers shaped philosophical thought and reality of human life for centuries and continue to do so. In concert with the above, as a Black woman, I tried to understand the socio-historical and cultural determinants of the way Black women's sexuality is commonly perceived. Views of the Black woman's body and sexuality are rooted in the insidious institution of slavery. My current exploration is also an excavation. I wanted to dig deep and extract the last vestiges of memory, the memory that clings to my cells and causes flesh, bone, and psyche to recoil from intimacy and trusting. This is memory that is only partially available to conscious awareness. Most of the memory is hidden from unconsciousness, emerging intermittently in dreams and in the forms of somatic resonance to people, environments, or situations. I know of a memory's truth by way of somatic confirmation that gives rise to emotional response. Memory in history is an embodied phenomenon. I have learned that my aloof and detached mind does not always speak truth. Rather, it often obscures truth for the sake of effective daily functioning. Using the heuristic paradigm, the journey of recovering wholeness is discussed. The central place of spirituality within this process is also revealed. This spirituality is based on the West African Yoruba Ifa tradition that was brought to the Western Atlantic region with the slave trade. African-based spirituality is earth-based. As such, it is embodied and comes alive in one's life through practice and application. Central to my reclamation process is an altar that I constructed, honoring my child self and asking for the guidance, love, and support of Yemaya. Yemaya is the Ifa Orisha, or deity, associated with the nurturing of children and the general affairs of women. She is aligned with our dreams. She is the mother of the ocean, teeming with life. There is no mountain of trouble that Yemaya cannot wear down, no sickness of heart that she cannot wash away, no desert of despair that she cannot flood with hope. I created a shrine for the spirit of my child self and her healing, transformational process. Author Maladoma Samay states, a shrine is where one goes to enter into communion with the other world. It is a place of beauty and mystery, and also the place of memory. On the shrine are images of myself as a child of 3, 4, and 7 years of age. A candle to the mothering Orisha, Yemaya, also graces the shrine. In part, I made the shrine to encourage my child self to communicate with me, and in this regard, employed Moustakas's self-dialogue technique that is similar to the Jungian technique of active imagination. Active imagination is used as a means to bring unconscious material into consciousness. It is an invitation to the unconscious to speak, knowing that the unconscious mind is paying attention. Active imagination is a counterpoint to dreams, developed by Jung for working with dreams. The self-dialogue or active imagination process is not as mysterious as it might seem. Most of us have some form of dialogue happening in our minds on a daily basis. We imagine how an important interaction will play out, for example. The difference is that here, we are directly engaging with elements of our unconscious or elements of our dreams. The process does involve temporarily displacing left brain primacy and diving into the uncharted waters of the non-rational or numinous. I invited my child self to visit me. I spoke to her with affection and listened to her with openness and respect.
Thank you. So Marion, as a beginning, her first question, I think when we were talking,
I'm sorry, hold on a second. What is going on here? When we were talking about this, we were, came to the decision to sort of ask each other, well, how did our time at CIS and in the Women's Spirituality Program influence our work and influence our writing? So I don't know if you'd like to begin by speaking to that.
Sure. I've worked for probably more than 25 years now as a registered nurse, and I understand the multiple injustices that plague Western culture, including economic, racial, and gender inequalities. And I've witnessed the shortcomings of our modern healthcare system and the negative outcomes of a medical industrial complex and big pharma. The Women's Spirituality Program honors the spirit inherent to all life. The interdisciplinary approach of the program gave me a broader understanding of the history and the sociocultural context of people's lives. By focusing on and having an opportunity to learn about women's mysteries, sacred arts, I was able to develop not only personally but professionally in ways that I know couldn't have been done in Western mainstream academia. So as a result of being a participant in the program, I was able to broaden my role as a healing practitioner. And today, working in psychiatric nursing, I feel that my work is more effective because of my experience in the Women's Spirituality Program. How about you, Annette? How has the program influenced your work?
You're muted, Annette.
What it did, you know, for me, I think it opened me up more to more of embodiment, to more looking at a broader range of epistemologies than I was used to working with. I worked with writing, and writing, and it was very creative and very healing. But through the program, I was able to not be so dependent or on my left brain, and to become more open to, not that I was not before, but sort of it gave me the academic underpinning to do that, you know, as opposed to being something I did on the side or because of my own spiritual interest and spirituality. I could bring that into the academic fold, so to speak, and therefore sort of broaden analysis. I think that's basically what I would like to say about that. And I noticed that, you know, a commonality in our work is that we both employ dreams, yeah, as this, you know, wonderful source of knowledge as an epistemology. And I was wondering about your process, and I spoke a bit, you know, in terms of, you know, what I read, but in terms of your work and how you employ dreams.
Yeah, I like that, because our essays are very different,
mm-hmm.
and yet there is that common feature in the use of dreams. And dreams are very powerful. They certainly serve a purpose, even when we don't understand them. I think in my work, I particularly look for the connections between my waking life, my creative process, and my dreams. And, you know, it wasn't until I've, as a human being, I've had dreams all my life, but I never really gave them much significance, really, until I started studying more about women's mysteries and sacred arts. And I've learned a great deal about myself and life through dreams. And I pay close attention to them, and I look for the inner connection. As an example, during an 8-month sojourn through France, Ireland, and Scotland in 2018-19, I noticed at the end of my trip that the rabbit seemed to play an important role both in my waking life and my dream life. During that 8-month time period, I had several interesting rabbit dreams, but also encountering rabbits on my walks and in graveyards and that. And so I think that it's important that even when we don't fully understand the why of it, that dreams require that we simply trust the process and allow things to unfold, mm-hmm. and be patient.
Yeah.
They're great teachers.
Yeah, thank you. Yeah, they certainly really are. And one thing, you know, with dreams is when we start to work with our dreams, the dreams become more coherent. They become more clearer. The stories become easier to follow, because dreams are so full of fantastical images. Sometimes things that just feel totally incoherent and they have no idea what's going on. And I know there are lots of drawn books on dream symbolism and the like, but after a while, as you work with your dreams, as I've worked with my dreams, as I discovered that I sort of can develop my own book of symbols, mm-hmm. because the symbols become relevant to me, and then the dreams are sort of in tune with that. The sort of, you know, mm-hmm. there's an interaction with that, and a symbol that might mean something for somebody else entirely will be personal to me and will come through in the dream in that way, for me. They're comforting, and they're confrontational, and they're challenging, and, you know, it's like, you know, having a therapist that takes no prisoners, so to speak, you know, that is because they truly can be challenging and can force us to face things that we might not be
ready to face. Or you have a great example, Marion, of the rabbit dream in your essay. And I was like, yes, you have these dreams that you wouldn't, would you dare share them with anyone else? Because it does seem so outrageous, you know, but at the same time are incredibly healing for, you know, for the individual. So, yeah.
Yeah, I agree.
Mm-hmm.
The beauty of being human. Although I think animals dream too, because my dog oftentimes when she's sleeping appears to be dreaming. So I think it's an important part of our consciousness.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I'm really lucky that I have a friend who has I've known for over 40 years, and I've watched her abilities develop over time, her sensitivity, her psychic awareness, her abilities. And one of her gifts is dreaming. So she wow. will, yeah, she was really of great help to me in my journey, my healing journey with childhood sexual abuse. She would often have dreams for me. You know, if I have a particular issue that I was dealing with, I couldn't understand, I'd say, well, can you have a dream about this or about this, you know, particular person? What was going on for this person? And sometimes, more than once, I think she would get a wall. She would get nothing. She would get a wall, meaning, you know, for her, meaning that I wasn't ready for the knowledge yet, or something that I had to discover for myself, mm-hmm. that she couldn't give me the information. Wow. So it's like, this really was, you know.
Isn't that something?
Yeah. Any more on dreams? We could talk about dreams for a long time. Yeah. And that's the whole active imagination process and working with the dreams, you know, really respecting the dream. And, you know, going back into the dream and talking to the characters of the dream. Yeah. So one, that was very therapeutic for me, you know, or just going, you know, going in and being of comfort to my child self in the dream, who might be afraid or something is coming up in the dream around my child self, and just going in. Sometimes it's going in and talking to myself as I was within the dream, or just going in with active imagination and just allowing through the unconscious whatever wants to come up to come out. And sometimes I'll just sit on the untype, sort of like stream of consciousness, to type it out. Not even thoroughly being consciously aware of what I'm typing, but just having that experience of that part of myself being listened to and being heard.
Yeah, mm-hmm. Hard work.
Yeah.
So beautiful.
Thank you. So let's see. We don't want to leave some time for questions, but I'll have another question for Marion. And of course, for you, Marion, nature is such an important element in healing. And you speak about walking medicine in your essay.
Mm-hmm.
And I was wondering if you could just say about, you know, speak a bit more about walking healing, especially in the context of healing sexual trauma.
Okay.
Or walking medicine.
Yeah. Walking and wandering is something that I've done since I was a small child, because my parents allowed my siblings and I to have free access to the outdoors, even when we lived in places like Kodiak Island and we're right near the ocean. We still had that freedom. And so it's something, for me, the importance of nature is that it's constant and reliable. The sun on any given morning will not say, I'm not feeling up to it, so I'm not going to rise today. The moon, day in and day out, is in sync with the tides. You can count on it. And for me, nature is omnipotent and omnipresent. And when I've gone through periods of crisis and turmoil, to be out and moving my body and walking in rhythm with the earth is a great comfort to me. It helps me sort out my thoughts and my emotions and really gain perspective on things. So the practice that I talk about in the essay about walking medicine is something that is simple to do. And the thing that I love most about being in France in the United Kingdom was the access to walking paths. I find it more challenging in North America because our culture has been built around roadways, whereas in Europe, it's built around walking trails that are still easily accessible. So walking is something we have to really plan for in our day, because we no longer rely on our feet to get from point A to point B. It's something that we have to intentionally schedule. And I don't have time to go over it, but in my essay, I provide three different practices that I use regularly, and one of them is walking medicine, and I describe and give some suggestions on how to do that.
Well, you know, you can go into a little more detail. You have it on page 161, in there. You know, that's basically the three steps. How do you engage with engage with your environment and your first step into the environment, and you know, your attitude.
Setting your intention. At the onset of my walks, I often recite the following verse to myself. Listen to the spirit, listen to the land, listen to the spirit, listen to the land. And so when you are grounded and have set your intention, step forward into that sacred space that you've created. You're ready to engage with your whole self, mind, heart, body, and spirit. Depending on the day and my level of stress, I sometimes simply begin walking and think of nothing else. Simply walk until I reach a quiet place within myself. As I relax and the tension leaves my body, I'm more able to focus my attention and become more acutely aware of my surroundings. And then I go on to give some suggestions of, you know, giving thanks for your body, giving thanks for the earth, and just allowing that time and that space to really decompress.
Especially when you're dealing with sexual trauma, one of the manifestations or ramifications is sort of, it's a disconnection from the body. You know, some things like you describe in walking medicine is feeling your body in the space, right? Feeling the breeze on your body, just communing with the environment, with the ground under your feet, with the trees, with, you know, just having that sensual and sensory awareness and connection. That's in an environment that feels safe and nurturing. There's a lot for bringing oneself, bringing your body and spirit and soul back into alignment.
Yeah, it can be very helpful. Oftentimes women who've suffered sexual abuse have difficulty doing sports, like riding a bicycle and you know, being physically active because of that armoring, that feeling frozen and paralyzed, especially in the lower half of the body. So walking is something that is just, you know, humans have done it since the beginning of time, and it's a simple practice to help you to reorient and re-embody yourself.
And I know, you also speak of art, and that's something else. I didn't speak to that portion, but you know, art is so important and therapeutic. You know, in terms of my own process, part of my what I call the creative synthesis portion of, I did a whole, you know, heuristic process. The heuristic process is developed by Clark Moustakas, and there's several steps to it, where at the end of it, it's called a creative synthesis. And part of that was, it wasn't so much as, it was art, but beyond that, it was sort of this reconnection with this play, with a truly playful 7-year-old. Right. I wanted, and it manifested like I wanted to get a coloring book, which I got, you know, a sacred woman coloring book. I wanted to jump rope. I just wanted to do all these things that were just, you know, incredibly playful and unlike my usual personality. So I was like, okay, this, you know, she's happier. She's feels more, you know, there's more healing. I could sense that healing happening. Yeah, through that. And the art. You know, there's art that came up is because I want to play and do art, and there's art that can just use just to get out non-verbal mush and crap and all that and pain that you can put it out and just put it onto a paper outside of yourself. Or create things that are absolutely beautiful that are representations of you know, some aspect of your being as you're going through healing. Mm-hmm. And you have some really beautiful examples of that you've made from found objects. My favorite was the is it a clamshell or an oyster shell with the mother mm-hmm. of pearl and the gold? I'm like, oh my gosh, and the gold mm-hmm. leaf. And it was like a boat for an ancestor vessel. And yeah. That was absolutely amazing. I wish I should just show it here, but yeah.
Thank you. Mm-hmm. No, it sounds like in your process that playfulness in art and the freedom to really express both the hard parts of your journey as well as the childlikeness, the child spirit. It's been really important, very powerful.
Yeah.
Why did you choose the Yoruba traditional religion as the context for your healing?
At the time, because it was done, I did this process a little while ago. I think I was just discovering Yoruba traditional religion. Diving more deeply into that religion, and because of its African basis and how it was brought over, I definitely felt affinity and kinship, and it's something that it was so embodied, and something and I could use the altar, I could use this space to create beauty, to create something of beauty to honor, you know, that those little my little beings, you know, as little beings with 3, 4, and 7 year old selves. And work with it, and to work with that in a physical way, and looking like visually, and just sit before the altar. And so the Yoruba traditional religion sort of gave me that ability, and sort of made, and also gave me that, because this happened within my family, and with this, you know, within my Black family, is also sort of that line, that healing thread. I thought that, and I felt like that ran through that, and that was important for me to do that, because, you know, as Charlotte Pierce Baker was saying, you know, like the question, like how that, excuse me, I won't curse, there's one of their own, you know, like own being yeah. racially own being family own being. So I really went on a deep dive of trying to understand on various levels, and I think using your traditional religion sort of helped me have a container, and you can say, you know, for that, you know, yeah.
For that, and dive. The image of the altar, to me came across as very nurturing, mm-hmm. But yet complex and personal, deeply personal. I love the portrait. I don't know if that was one that you did, the drawing of the girl, the portrait.
Mm-hmm.
No,
that was something that I don't know. I don't remember it being done, but my father gave it. It's on cloth. Something my father gave to me that was done when I was little. So,
wow. Yeah, very powerful.
Thank you. Let's see. I think we ran through our prepared. We have a couple other prepared questions. I'm looking at the time, and I definitely want to leave time for Q&A with all of you who are present. So, yeah, any questions or comments?
Annette, this is V. I just enabled the chat again. We had some weird artificial intelligence inputs. So I just announced to participants if they would like to join us by posting on chat their questions, or maybe just speaking up, you know, unmuting themselves and speaking up.
Yeah, please feel free to unmute yourselves and just and speak.
And while that's happening, I actually would like to invite Courtney Kay, our admissions counselor for Women's Spirituality Program, and here is why. First of all, my name is Violeta Krasnic. I'm a program coordinator for Women's Spirituality. I'm a sexual violence survivor and a long-term women's human rights and human rights advocate. We've been fighting against violence against women and violence in general for many years, including against myths. One of the biggest ones being that, you know, the sexual violence happens to specific people for specific reasons. In that sense, you know, kind of absolving of responsibility the perpetrators. Courtney Kay is a staff member. She is admissions counselor for women's spirituality. She herself has an experience of both violence and harassment, as well as of an activism to share. So Courtney, if you would go ahead, please, and briefly tell us about what are you working on?
Sure. Thanks so much, V, and just happy to be here as always, you know, with Dr. Annette Williams and Marion. Really nice to meet you virtually and to see Alka and V. Yeah, happy to be the admissions counselor for this program. I mean, a lot of amazing programs at CIIS, but women's spirituality is especially just a near and dear topic to my heart and soul. So yeah, I am happy to talk about it briefly, but not too much time because I know there's lots of people who want to speak. So yeah, I had the experience, unfortunately, of dating somebody who I would now consider, you know, in retrospect, like a narcissistic sociopath, unfortunately, very deep level of narcissism. Basically, somebody who has a history of this. I'm not the only woman who experienced what happened, but yeah, definitely a traumatic experience in the sense of meeting someone, falling in love with them, thinking they're a very good person. And having a, you know, a real beautiful, deep relationship, and then them finding out that they had cancer come back into their lives. This person told me they were in remission in the past, but cancer came back and they proceeded to get very sick in front of me. And I took care of them thinking that they did have stage four cancer, the full on works, you know, port in their chest, falling down in front of me, throwing up, everything like that, put my life on pause to go to New York for a stem cell treatment. And found out that this person never had cancer, has never had cancer. And this is just, I don't know if it's a deep hatred of women, but it's a pattern that this person has been repeating for going on 8 years now. I found out that it was 9 other women that experienced that in addition to me over the course of like 8 years, probably many, many more than that. But when I found out, it was really deeply painful. And, you know, you think, oh my gosh, who's this person I've been with all this time? And you feel so violated and manipulated, and all those encounters that you had, you know, emotionally, sexually, all feel like betrayal. And yeah, it's just a really weird feeling to experience that. But when I found out, the only thing that I knew that I needed to do was to expose it. And so I don't know, the way that I've been processing it in a lot of ways, in addition to just, you know, my own healing journey, has been to try to actually talk about it publicly and to help other women. So in the process of my own research and figuring out the truth, I ended up finding out a lot of other women and was able to warn a lot of other women as well. So like by messaging a bunch of his followers on Instagram that I got, I was able to find like 2 other women before they went down the same path. And keep them from that. And then I've now located the current wife and gotten her out of there before it got really, really bad, got it and escalated to the FBI, and basically am working on creating a story as a podcast and actually talking to Netflix producers as well about it. So it would probably be a larger docuseries about mental health in the dating industry, but we're actually doing a lawsuit as well against the dating apps because so much of their actions don't really do much to help their users. And most of the time it impacts women more so than men, the level of violence and hurt that happens. I've had friends who've been nearly murdered off dating apps, a lot of really deep abuse, and the apps don't do that much about it. And these offenders can get right back on there. And so there's a lot of places where these people are able to find others. And so I want the story to just hopefully be one of empowerment because it's me working together with some of these other women. I've kind of led a coalition of us. We have a big group thread. We get on calls thinking about how we can do something meaningful from this really wild, terrible experience that we all experience with this person. And so I've actually even been talking to Cecilia from Tinder Swindler, if anyone watched that. And she's starting a whole nonprofit around helping people who've experienced romance fraud specifically. So I hope that the story is one of empowerment, of getting together with other women and doing something. And we're trying to seek some sort of justice, but more to come.
Thank you, Courtney.
Sorry, that was too long. It's hard to, to shorten it, but anyway.
Oh, thank you.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. It was, yeah. There's a lot to say there, a lot to unpack.
Right. Lots to unpack. Thank you for that.
Are there questions in the chat that I haven't checked, B, or anyone? I saw somebody had taken themselves off of. Yes, Medea.
I'm going to get the book now because I often don't think of, even though I've experienced sexual trauma or violence, I don't, listening to the way you all, and I'm going to get the book now around this conversation of bringing it forward. Number one, I really appreciated both your shares and Marion, your context around nature and like what nature, that relationship around the healing aspect of being in nature. That's one thing that helped me with some other grief I'm still coming through. But I'm really being called to look at this thing around sexual violence as it relates to our wounds, women, and knowing that women give birth to these people who, you know, perpetuate it. So it just, it really gave me a lot of, like, Medea, you need to look into this. So I appreciate you all. Thank you all. And much love.
Thank you.
Yeah. Hi. Thank you so much for this incredible sharing of your personal journeys. As somebody who has worked and works still specifically with women and their wombs and sexual trauma healing as a somatic sex therapist or somatic sex educator, I really find this integration of spirituality as essential in the profession, although it's not quite being discussed enough. And so I want to say thank you for bringing into the context of academia as it really pertains to how we're all working together and how important it is to do these deep healing journeys. I'm curious if either one of you has any thoughts around epigenetics and how that has played a role in your ancestral healing, or if that has been looked at by either one of you, and any alternative awareness and thoughts around what you're focused on, or if there's any courses on that in academia.
I can speak to that a little bit. I haven't not looked at it specifically, but I do hold, and based on other spiritual work or other things that I've done around my ancestors, I do believe that on my other beliefs in the multiverses and how time is intersected and how lives are intersected and spirit beings and spirit is intersected, that everything that we do to heal ourselves sort of radiates out. Right. So that's my personal, I don't put it within the context of epigenetics. I have not studied that, but you know, I know of it, and I know, you know, peripherally more than in depth. But it is my belief that, yeah.
Yeah, I agree. And I had an interesting experience when I was in Scotland, because I felt initially my goal was to go to France and do research with some scholars that I had met, and that plan fell through. So I ended up in Ireland and Scotland, which, it wasn't my plan, but it was perfect. And when I spent a month in the Highlands, and it was middle of winter, and I'd been there about 3 weeks, and I felt like my ancestors were French, Irish, and Scottish, and I only learned as a result of the Women's Spirituality Program that about my Irish and Scottish ancestors through the mother line class. And so in Scotland, I felt like I needed to do a ritual for my Scottish ancestors. And so I set a dream intention, and had this amazing dream of a woman. And in the dream, she and I had a conflict. There were, that night, I had three dreams. One was a conflict with a woman. The other was a ritual. And the third dream was there was an Indigenous man, either Pict or Gaelic. He was a Scottish Indigenous person who had come up with a resolution for the conflict between the woman and I. I don't remember any of the details, but I felt like there's something going on here with my ancestors. I don't know what it is, but I'm just going to honor that. And I, to this day, I don't know what that was all about, but I feel that if we honor our ancestors and ourselves and our healing process, that healing is occurring. And we may never really come to understand it, but that we can trust that there's a purpose in it.
Thank you, Marion. And when you were speaking, I remember, you know, you said it's three, and three is such a significant mm-hmm. number, right? Mm-hmm. In terms of working with spirit and working with our dreams. And the night I established and set up my shrine on the altar, I had a series of dreams, also three. And that sort of helped reminded me of that. We really in this presentation really focused on, you know, on spirit and on the spiritual healing. And we didn't speak as much to the, you know, to the internalization of the oppression and, you know, all the other ways in which we're damaged, you know, and we really want to in here focus on the healing, and the spiritual approaches to that healing, and how that, you know, so as you're speaking, Lucia, of how that healing can spread and spreads through our ancestors and through generations and maybe into the future, depending on how you view time and yeah, how absolutely. Time flows. So, yeah.
Thank you for your question, Lucia.
I'm looking at the time. I think we have time for maybe one more question or one more comment. I see a lot of things in the chat, but I haven't read them.
In the chat, we have a lot of gratitude, okay. A lot of thanks.
Okay.
People are thanking you for Motherland Project as well. I found an article in a medical journal on violence against women and stress-related disorders seeking for associated epigenetic signatures, a pilot study. I can share that with Lucia.
Okay. Well, thank you so much, Marion, for being here. It was so exciting to see when I picked, you know, as we're, you know, sending in our you know, our final drafts and, you know, to the journal, and it had the list of contributors. I'm going, wait a minute, there are three of us.
I know.
I was spirituality program.
Yeah, I too was surprised and very pleased.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, to see that. So maybe at some point in the future, Sandra will be able to join us.
Yeah, that would be great.
To expand the conversation. So. Okay, it's about three. So don't take off yet, because we're going to have a bit of a closing for the 30th anniversary celebration. So I think I'll just move right into that at this point. So I'm just going to say, you know, thank you for attending and for participating in the Women's Spirituality 30th Anniversary Celebratory Series, featuring the work of our core faculty and adjunct faculty, students, and alumna. We were especially pleased to have as keynote speaker, renowned feminist author and social critic, Minna Salami, well known for her book, Sensuous Knowledge, A Black Feminist Approach for Everyone. We open the 30th Anniversary Celebratory Series with a message from Dr. Mara Keller, Women's Spirituality co-founder and Professor Emerita. In closing, it is my privilege to share with you remarks and the beautiful embodiment of spirit from one of my mentors, Arisika Razak. Arisika Razak, Professor Emerita, and former chair of the Women's Spirituality Program at CIIS, is currently a core teacher at the East Bay Meditation Center in Oakland, California. Her current research interests include Africana wisdom traditions, Buddhism and womanism, and embodied spirituality and movement. A graduate of Spirit Rock's dedicated practitioner program and the Sounds True Mindfulness Meditation Teacher Certification Program with Jack Kornfeld and Tara Brock, Arisika leads community-based sanghas in the Western Insight comfort-based meditation tradition and is a regular contributor to Buddhist books and periodicals. She regularly presents at online and in-person conferences and has led spiritual and healing workshops and ritual celebrations for over 40 decades. Her teachings incorporate diverse spiritual traditions, multicultural feminisms, queer theory, and contemporary diversity theory. And with that, I will turn it over to V to share Arisika's message and dance.
Thank you.
Greetings, kinfolk. As we began by honoring the land, I want to end by honoring of the land. This is a piece by Joy Harjo. It's raining in Honolulu. There's a small mist at the brow of the mountain. Each leaf or flower or taro, tree and bush shivers with ecstasy. The rain songs of all the flowering ones who have called for rain can be found there, flourishing beneath the currents of singing. Rain opens us like flowers or earth that has been thirsty for more than a season. We stop all of our talking, quick thinking to drink the mystery. We listen to the breathing beneath the breathing. We hear how the rain became rain, how we became human. The wetness saturates and cleans everything, including the perpetrators of the second overthrow. We will plant songs where once there were curses. I wanted to start there because our program has always honored the earth and the struggles to preserve the earth. Our program has always honored a diversity of struggle for liberation, and we know that spirituality is intimately bound up with our freedom struggles. Our program has honored our bodies, our diverse bodies, large, small, thick, thin, our precious black, brown, yellow, red, and white bodies, all sexualities, abilities, and genders. And of course, our program has always celebrated our ancestors, our literary and academic ancestors, our blood and activist ancestors. The program has changed since I began teaching 25 years ago, and it's wonderful to celebrate the 30th anniversary of our program. I want to congratulate each one of you who studies here, each one of you who teaches, each one of you who serves as staff, whether that's staff for the program or for the greater institution at large. Our program has always focused on women, gender, spirituality, and social justice, even if that was not part of our name in 1999. It has always included marginalized and socially targeted individuals and groups, some of whom did not and do not call themselves women. In the late 1980s, women's spirituality was a movement, a spiritual practice, and an academic endeavor. And I hope that those of you who are studying here now find an academic home that blends your lived experience with theory and praxis. I hope you find a brave space that honors a diversity of cultural traditions and a foundation for new forms of social justice activism. All of these are part of our academic work. For as Gloria Anzaldúa states, you must stop in the middle of the field and under your breath, ask the spirits, animals, plants, y tu muertos, to help you string together a bridge of words, to give back to nature, los espíritus and others, a gift wrested from the events in your life, a bridge that takes you home to the self. This bridge that Ansel Zua is talking about is a bridge that has always been part of our program. Our ability to authentically engage, to remember our traditions, to build alliances and coalitions in the face of seemingly irreconcilable differences, to create new paradigms and recover old ones, to develop new knowledge. These capacities are at the heart of our program. They are at the heart of the work that must be done if humanity is to survive. I was going to speak to you about the apocalyptic times we are living in, but I don't really need to do that. We know that many of our dreams for building a just and equitable society, a beloved community that holds all species, all beings, in a balanced and harmonious web of life, is being threatened. We know that we're living in a global pandemic of hatred, that our Earth is threatened. The real question is how we respond, whether we succumb to despair or rise up in support of our common humanity, in our camaraderie with all sentient life. As Amanda Gorman says, may this be the day we come together. Mourning, we come to mend. Withered, we come to weather. Torn, we come to tend. Battered, we come to better. This is the premise of our program. This is the faith of all our human ancestors. This is the medicine we are bringing to the future. Ashe, Homotakye Oyasi, Emlakesh, Shalom, Salam, so mote it be, Namaste. Thank you, thank you, thank you.
Pretty women wonder where my secret lies. I'm not cute or built to suit a fashion model size. When I start to tell them, they think I'm telling lies. I say it's in the reach of my arms, the spread of my hips, the stride of my steps, the curl of my lips. I'm a woman. Walk into a room just as cool as you please. And to a man, fellow stand or fall down on their knees. Then they swarm around me like a hive of honeybees. I say it's in the fire in my eyes, flash of my teeth, the swing of my waist, the joy in my feet. I'm a woman.
Phenomenal.
I'm a woman. why my head's not bowed. I don't shout or jump about or have to talk real loud. When you see me passing, it ought to make you proud. I say it's in the click of my heels, the bend of my hair, the palm of my hand, the need for my care. Cause I'm a woman. That's me.
Oh, it is Arisika Razak. I wonder.
So wonderful.
That's a wonderful, beautiful way to close the series.
Thank you.
So it's much gratitude to everyone for being a part of it. And here's for 30 more years. 30 more years. So
drop mic, drop Zoom.
Okay, there's nothing to say after that.
It's like we can sit in silence or in laughter, but that's it.
Again, thank you, everyone. It's been wonderful, beautiful. So much gratitude to all. And Marion, again, thank you for taking.
And thank you, Annette, as well. Okay. Thank you, everyone who participated. I'll stop recording, but please keep